Thank you for joining us today. My name is Bill Baker. I'm with Firestorm in Atlanta. We're pleased to have you with us. This is part of the Crisis Coach webinar series that's presented in conjunction with support from the Tennessee Association of Independent Schools. It's the fourth in the series for 2016. You can go to to firestorm.com and watch previous webinars in this series and also those from the prior 2 years. Today, we're discussing the containment myth, misinformation magnets. Our presenter is going to be Blair Neville, who is our principal in the state of New Jersey. We also would like you to become our friend on Facebook for Firestorm Solutions. You can follow us on Twitter, Firestorm Soul. There is a hashtag. That hashtag is Crisis Coach. Firestorm transforms crisis into value and empowers you to manage risk and crises. Firestorm expertise is crisis management, critical decision support, crisis communications, crisis public relations, and consequence management. Please keep in mind the presentation today is not complete without the accompanying oral comments and discussion, and our work product should be read in conjunction with advice from your organization's personal counsel. In addition, do not interpret this information as legal advice or legal opinion. Firestorm is delighted to have this webinar series underwritten by the Tennessee Association of Independent Schools. And we're delighted also to have Rich Martin with us. Rich, over to you, please.
Thanks, Bill. We're pleased, as always, to be working with Firestorm as a sponsor of TAIS to bring our schools and other schools in our area information on how to deal with manage crisis, how to prepare for crisis, how to evaluate whether you are prepared or not. And Firestorm for the last 2 years has been doing a great job of helping us with the webinars and with live workshop presentations such as the one we did on March 3rd of this year here. And we look forward to continuing that relationship and continuing to help our schools get information about how to deal with crises of all kinds. So thanks, Bill. We look forward to another great webinar and turn it back to you.
Great, Rich. This is Blair Neville. Thank you for your comments. And again, thank you very much for your support. We really appreciate it. All the support you've given us, and looking forward to providing some information on crisis communications today and dealing with misinformation. As I was putting the slides together for the presentation, it reminded me of a commercial that I've seen a few years back and really enjoyed, and I think it really typifies the kind of confusion and misinformation that can happen out on the web and social media. And if you kind of think of the way the commercial set up with two young people standing on a street corner and one says to the other, where'd you hear that? And then the comment comes back, well, I heard it on the internet. And the young man says, so you believe it? And the young lady says, yes, sure I do. You can't put anything on the internet that's not true. So the gentleman says, where did you hear that? And of course her comment is, on the internet. And that's when the less than attractive French model shows up and says bonjour for the date, and off they go. And so again, we're not going to do the presentation in French today, but I think that the quote and that commercial really typifies the kind of confusion that is out there. All the great information that the internet can provide and the research and the tools that are available are wonderful. But unfortunately, there's a lot of opportunity and a lot of abuse when it comes to misinformation. And that misinformation can create some serious impacts. And it's like a magnet. It's just a magnet for confusion, for complexity, and for an it's an opportunity for essentially a crisis. And it's strong. Yeah, I must remember that bad news gets headlines. Good news is a little bit hard to sell, so people focus more on the negative side. And if you've been on a few of our webinars in the past, you've probably heard us say that if you're explaining, you're losing. And that's really the situation we're trying to avoid. If there's misinformation or commentary out in the blogosphere about you or your school or your student body or sports team or whatever the case may be, how do you control it? How do you get your hands around it and wrestle it back to something that's manageable? How do you stay in control? If there's not information out there, and how do you stop it before it happens? What are those leading indicators that allow you to get in front of it and slow it down? And that's kind of what we want to talk about today and putting some plans together to do that. And again, it just bears repeating. It's true. There's a lot of great information. The internet is an invaluable tool to all of us for teaching, for just our daily lives. But at the same time, there's so much out there that is just confusing and as I say, half-truths. I just picked a couple. Given we're in the middle of an election cycle here, I thought the first bullet point was kind of appropriate, is that even after published information, even after copies of birth certificates, there's still people struggle with the fact that our president may not have been born here. Regardless of your support or not, facts are facts. Jade Helm, if you're not aware of that, was simply a military exercise in the West, very extensive, very large. But if you go into Google and check it out, it talks about martial law, it talks about states seceding, it talks about invasion of our borders. Amazing, crazy, crazy commentary, and people being drawn into that discussion, again, when the military comes out, it's an exercise. The last one is just one that's kind of a local news item here. It was a 1% tip on a very large bill and got a lot of press and a lot of commentary because obviously people got emotional about it and it's wrong. But the reality is it wasn't even a half-truth. It was not true, but still got attention, got awareness, and it was hard to shake. And it's a growing trend. This stickiness of this information is hard to shake. And the reality is that we all have phones in our pockets. We all are sort of junior reporters now. It amazes me when you see accidents and see crisis happening and people have the wherewithal and the forethought to bring out their phones and film this in the middle of an aircraft going down or an emergency landing. I don't think I could do it. But people do it, and that information flows out so quickly and gets out there so fast, and unfortunately is hard to shake, is hard to turn back. And again, unfortunately, many of the facts get lost in the process. Speed is more important. How quickly can I get to the market? How quickly can I get my pictures on Instagram? Or how quickly can I get my stuff on Snapchat to get out to my friends? And the fact that it's true or not true, well, we'll discuss that a little later. So I say that the internet's a cupboard of kind of tasty morsels of kind of almost accurate data, opinion labeled as fact, and that's something that as business managers, and the school is a business, you need to A, understand, and B, know how to kind of get your hands around and how to react to protect your students, your families, your reputation. And that's really the key. The pain point here is, and the collateral damage to all of this is your brand. It's that trust. It's not so much the brand, it's the trust in the brand. Because I really look at that trust as an emotion. You can produce some of the best services, the best students. You can have a great product in the marketplace. But if people don't trust you, regardless of how strong the brand is, it's going to affect you, and it can affect you with revenue, and it can affect you with reputation, and it can affect you with your business. Years ago, when I started my career, many, many years ago, there was an old saying, and I was in the sales environment, and it was, people buy from people they like. So empathy and social intelligence were key to successful selling. And if they don't like you, they won't buy. Well, that hasn't changed. If they don't like you, they're not going to want to deal with you. But I've kind of changed that saying and said it's more about trust, not about like. They may like you, and they may realize you've got a great service or a product, But if they don't trust you, if they don't trust your brand or what you're saying, they're not going to work with you, and they're not going to buy your product, or they're not going to support your cause, or they're not going to commit to your school. And that trust, if it's broken, is very, very hard to rebuild. So some of the things we'll talk about today is protecting that trust capital, because it is a capital. It's what people look to you, and underlying all the discussions you may have with your community, with your families, if they trust you're doing what you say you're doing, and they trust you're providing the best service you can, they will be back. If they don't, they may not. And that trust is very, very easily damaged by misinformation, very easily damaged by wrong opinions. And today, there's so many vehicles for people to get out and stake their claim and have their voice heard, that you, as a management group, and as a shepherds for that brand, have to be able to get that information, understand what's going on, and be able to respond to it quickly and build that trust, because it is an intangible asset. And that intangible asset allows you to build your brand, build your image. It allows you to attract the best talent, the best teachers want to work for you. Families want to be part of your community because of that. It sets up competitive barriers that help you keep and attract the population. And it can be easily lost. And unfortunately, it's not about you doing a bad job. If you do all the right things, but the messages that are out there, the information that's flowing out, is damaging it, that can affect you. And in reality, you may not be in the wrong. And that's the most difficult part of this. So how do we control it? Simply, you don't want to be the little guy on the right-hand side here. You don't want to be the last to know, and unfortunately many people are, because there's a lot of barriers. There's a lot of barriers to that information coming in. We're all busy, we all have jobs to do, so collecting and sorting through data and information can be a tiring task. What data do we collect? How do we collect it? How do we get it? In a school environment, your student body knows what's going on. Your employees know what's going on. How do those half-truths and rumors maybe get to you so you can sort through them? How do you sort through that information to get to the word that's on the bottom, intelligence? And we like to look at this as you make your decisions. Unfortunately, most people make their decisions on information, where you should be making it on both information and insight. And insight is really history. It's intuition. It's experience. It's a little bit intangible, but it's understanding what's happening coupled with the data that you can collect, the information, collect, gives you that ability to say, I now have intelligence I can make decisions on. And that is difficult to do. And, you know, well, I'll give you one kind of an example. As we've seen that we in our work with schools where we've had bad actors and we've had violent attacks, and the industry has come back and said that in their studies that 80% of the time somebody knew something was going to happen. At least one person knew that the event was either going to take place or had a huge, high potential of taking place. And up to 67% of the time, two or more people knew. So how do you get that information? What is it that stops that information from flowing through? How do you break that barrier down? And it's tough to do. And your parents and your families, they have an expectation. They have an expectation that when they hand over their kids to you, they expect to get them back in the same condition as when they sent them to you. Hopefully a little bit smarter, but at the same time, they're expecting that they're coming back. And that expectation is you should know what's going on, and you should know what's happening in your community and your environment. And sometimes that's hard to do. And we'll talk a little bit about some ways to control and understand that. And it's a double-edged sword, though. You know, if you look at it like a scale, that visibility, we call it visibility vulnerability, there's a balance there. You as a community and a school want the visibility. you want marketing and advertising, and you want good visibility. You want people reading your web pages. You want your community hearing about the success of sports teams, the good things that are going on in your school. That's great. That's positive. Unfortunately, all that visibility also creates a target. It creates an opportunity for, as I said, bad actors to take advantage of it. It also, given there's so much visibility out there, any little hiccup can become very visible and can become damaging. When I was working through the presentation, I have a sophomore in high school, and I just jumped on the high school's website and I went through it. It's a fairly large high school here in the Northeast, and there are about 51, 52 clubs on their webpage. And then my son's on the track team. There's probably a dozen sports teams in the school, given female and male sports teams. And I know the track team has a Facebook page, and they use it for communication. That's how they communicate with each other in times and schedules. So I kind of sat down and said, here's a school that has a web page and has a Facebook page, but potentially has maybe 20, 25, I don't know for sure, other Facebook pages and maybe web pages that are out there with their name on it. So that visibility doesn't just extend to what you can manage. It extends, and that net is very, very broad. So A, you have a risk of what's going on those pages, and hopefully the student advisor, the teacher that's responsible for it, is keeping an eye on those things, and you know, that's great. But at the same time, as an administration, you look back and say, how many touch points are my name on that have a potential for some sort of abuse or an issue? How do I keep control of that? And how do I keep visibility on that? And it's difficult. You should be seeing a lot of dots on your screen. It's not an eye chart. It's you're out there. Your school's out there. You're in the middle of all of those dots. And as I said before, you're using the good visibility to extend your brand and communicate with your community and your teachers and students and families. Unfortunately, if there's an event at your school or a crisis of some type occurs, you become more visible, and it's easy to see where you stand in the midst. It doesn't take much. You stand out very, very quickly. Now, if you have some programs in place and you have a communications plan that can address this quickly, can see the leading indicators, pick up information early in the cycle so you can respond to them, you can communicate to your stakeholders that this is wrong or here's how you're handling it, because you sometimes can't make it go away. But if you're communicating properly, here's what we're doing and here's how we're addressing the concerns or questions, the dot starts to disappear, because people see the trust, they understand you're managing the brand and you're dealing with the situation. Unfortunately, if those leading indicators aren't addressed and you're not communicating properly with your families, if you're not communicating properly with your stakeholders, if you're not sending the right message, or as most often happens, you send wrong messages, this happens. Your visibility becomes much larger and much stronger. It's not that schools and people that we deal with don't want to communicate or don't want to deal with the problem. It's many times the messages are confused. They're turned around. They're not directed at the right people. The messenger is not the right messenger. And having control of that and having that part of your communications plan allows you to keep control of that and avoid that large dot. So how do you do it? How do you know what's out there? How do you collect that data? And if you look at the graph, you'll see that there's three pieces to it. And the green is very obvious. You know what you know. You know it. This is your business. In your environment, these are the data and the details that you're familiar with. The blue part is what you don't know. You know it. If you need legal advice, you hire lawyers. If you need security advice to look at a security program, you know you're not an expert. You know what you don't know. You hire that staff to be able to do it. The large piece, the orange piece, is what's the scary piece. That's what you don't know what you don't know. How do you know how to address it? How do you know what talent you need to address it? You don't know. Things are happening out there and you're unaware of them. And that's where we come back to that point of, you know, information, plus insight equals intelligence. You can collect the data out there, but if you don't have that insight, if you don't have a baseline to work from, if you don't have some experience and commentary on that information, hard to create intelligence from it, which allows you to make those correct and cogent and timely decisions. And it's tough. As a manager, you're trained to make decisions, but you're trained to make decisions on data that you have. You're trained to collect information, analyze it, and deal with it. If it's half-truths or wrong, in a time of crisis, you still have to make decisions. You don't have the luxury of saying, I'll put this off to tomorrow. So the more you can, the more information and insight you have and intelligence, the better decision-making you have. The first step is what we call predictive intelligence. It's understanding what's out there, collecting that data, collecting the information, and understanding it, putting it in some format that you can use. And you're looking at newsworthy events, you're looking at the information on websites and blog articles and commentary and Facebooks, and collecting some of that information. So what we do for customers, and there's tools out there that you can use internally, you're collecting that social media information, phrases and streams, keywords, issues that are going on, and you're putting them into a format where you're creating a baseline. This is what's happening in our community. This is what's going on. And then, if there's an actual crisis happens, you can look at the changes. That predictive intelligence looks at the changes, and then you can respond to them. So you have a baseline. If there's an event or a commentary, you can respond to it quickly because you're tracking it. If there's an event or commentary or an issue, and all of a sudden information starts to explode in one area against your baseline, you have the ability to look back and say, I can now go address it. I have the communication tools to deal with it. I have the messages to deal with it. But I know where to go to deliver those messages because I have this intelligence. So creating an intelligence model where you understand what's happening out there, you're able to collect the information, building a baseline to it so you understand what norm looks like. Then if something happens, or even probably more importantly, if nothing happens but you see a rise in that information or you see those red flags appearing, you can respond quickly to them. And how do you respond? Well, I took out crisis from this and I put in consequence management simply because that's what you want to avoid. And as I mentioned before, as managers and as leaders in the school, you're expected to make decisions. And typically, in a crisis environment, the information you get, especially in the first 24 hours, always tends to be an element of error in it. It can be wrong. And that's just part of what happens in a crisis. It's confusion. There's confusion going on. There's a great deal of drama happening. And you have to be able to sort through that. And sometimes you just don't have the chance. You still have to make decisions. So to avoid a consequence management issue where you've made a decision and now the result of that is even greater, those dominoes start to fall on that slide. You see the dominoes, they start to fall. You end up spending most of your time dealing with the consequence of your comment or somebody's comment, the consequence of not having addressed a problem early enough. Let's avoid those consequences. That little chart on the top is called an OODA loop. And it's a good example. It's just kind of a very simple example of a process to go through. And the way you should start to think, if I'm in an environment where I have to start making decisions and managing the process, how do I do it? And this was developed during actually the Korean War. There was a Colonel Boyd who was a pilot. And he looked at a squadron of American pilots and said that they were much better than the Korean pilots. Their success rates were much, much higher. And he kind of said, why? Because the other pilots were trained. And he discovered that, there was what was going on was they were going through a process that helped them gain control and superiority in the air. And the process was very simple. They had observed that the American fighters were much more maneuverable and could respond much quicker than the MiGs. And with that, they could react faster, and the MiGs were just slower to react, which put them in a superior position. So again, the process was simple. They made an observation. They then oriented an they then took that information that the MiGs weren't as maneuverable. They said, if we make decisions and we they cannot respond as fast, which they did. They decided to do that, and then they acted on it, which allowed them to be in control. And they learned from it and just continued through that loop. So we've kind of expanded that model a little bit and said, okay, in a crisis situation or in an event, this is a process to follow. A, it avoids that consequence management because it allows you to make better decisions. You need to understand what's going on. That's to collect the facts. As I said before, an intelligence network allows you to collect those facts more efficiently, allows you to respond much quicker. But once you understand or collect the data, you make a decision on what you have, act on it, and then most importantly, monitor it. That's one of the keys. What's going on? Who's doing what? And then adjust to it. And again, back through the loop. That adjustment says, have facts changed? Have we got new facts? We haven't. Great. Keep going through the process. So those simple steps give you a guideline for how to deal with those issues, and then in turn avoid that consequence management, which becomes a bigger issue, which then starts to erode that trust, and it all comes back in that circle. As you can see, I like the picture of the lion here, so I put him on. But again, it exemplifies the confusion that can be out on the internet, and it puts you in a position of how do I protect that brand, how do I protect and build that trust, or how do I regain it? And you regain it by decision making, responding, having a communication process, which we just talked a little bit about some of the decisions. But we'll talk about how you build a program to protect and regain your brand and that trust. At Firestorm, in our communications, our crisis communication plans and programs we work with schools, we always use a predict, plan, perform model, three-step model. And again, a very simple process goes behind that. So first one is predict. Who's the audience and what are their concerns? That's really the key. If you have to communicate to somebody about something, who are you communicating to? And again, this is where I said before that it's not the media's job to communicate for you. You need to think about your families. You need to think about your students. You need to think about your employees, your board. If you're associated with the church, church or any other organization you might be associated with, those are different audiences. The messages need to be tailored to them. And the key to that is, it's the same fundamental message, it's the same type of data, but different groups have different needs, they hear things differently, the messenger may not be the same, and the same person that's talking to your student body delivering a message may not be the same person talking to your board of trustees. How do you make sure those messages are the same with different people? How do you make sure the messages are delivering the same kind of information without causing confusion? And again, the media, you may have to talk to them given the event, but you talk to them on your terms and at your time frame. And I'll give you a good example. A very simple example is if you had a fire, if you had first responders coming to your school, many cases, media is not far behind. Whether it's a fire or a burst water pipe or whatever the case may be, is that environment. You have a lot of confusion. You may be put on the spot, asked for what's going on, what's happening. And the key here is, I don't want to be invasive. I need to have an answer. But at the same time, when you think about it, the answer is very simple. Who's in control at that point in time? It's the first responders, the fire, police, whoever happens to be there. They're the ones that know what's going on. They're the ones that are in control. You're focused on your students and making sure they're safe and making sure that they're out of the school and making sure that they're being looked after. So dealing with the media is not something you want to do, but avoiding them is not something you want to do. So in that particular case, the message is clear. I'm dealing with families, I'm dealing with the students. The first responders are in control. Talk to them. They know the facts. They understand what's going on. They will share it. Once I have all the data, once I have all my facts, I'll be more than happy to share that with you and share what we're going to do. In the meantime, they're the ones that are in control. And, you know, give me your card. I'll be back to you as soon as I have the information I can share. You're not avoiding, you're not defending, you're not making excuses, you're not making no comments, which puts you in the wrong. It allows you to get back to what you need to do. So again, having those tailored messages early allows you to be able to respond that way. And again, media is something you deal with on your terms at the right time. And then finally, step three is to perform. Is focus on three messages. Understand the three messages that apply to you, the messages that you want to deliver in that particular situation. And that falls back to different messengers with different audiences. Those three key messages will be consistent and will keep your focus and keep your message framed to avoid confusion, avoid interpretation, avoid someone taking, you can imagine someone taking the message from two or three different from people and going out into the internet and saying, here's what I heard, which is all different or all confusing. Now you're dealing with a different issue. That's what you're trying to avoid. The process to be able to make those, simply, again, predict, plan, perform model. What's known? What's going on? What's happening at the time? And gathering that information and thinking about that predict, plan, perform method of digesting and working through that information. Note the facts. Note what's happening, time, source, what information's flowing, is it verified? As I said earlier, is it a half-truth or a full-truth, or is it something that you're not sure? It's okay to collect the details, but note it, timestamp it, know what you can trust and not trust. Because that's what you want to be communicating when you have to. And then look at priorities, assigning it to somebody, assigning that communication, who's speaking to our board, who's speaking to the church, who's speaking to the community, who's speaking to our parents. Make sure that they're trained, they follow the messaging, they do it, and then get the feedback, which then in turn will maybe tailor the message again. A few questions on the bottom of the slide, which are great to have in the back when you're talking to people who are working with you, when you're dealing with your crisis management team or your incident management team who's working with you. What do we know? Are we concerned about it? Yes, no. If we are, what are we going to do about it? What do we think we're going to do about it? If we're not, let's move on. What's your plan around those issues? Do we communicate? Not. How are we going to monitor this? If we send out a message, if we respond to these issues, how are we monitoring what's going on so that we can continue that feedback loop, which is vital? And what are you going to communicate? Who's going to do it and how? And just those simple questions, if you challenge everything with those simple questions, you're going to continually be able to have, you can continually be able to build a trust, you'll be able to communicate effectively, and you'll be communicating as accurately as you can. This is a great tool to put in a handbook or put in your communications plan. And fundamentally, it's your commitment. I keep coming back to that idea of how do you avoid misinformation? Well, sometimes you can't, but the key is how do I continue to build my trust? I'll deal with the misinformation and you deal with the communication, but this is your commitment. And the first comment again, communications with the media in a crisis does not benefit anybody except the media. Always remember that. So I don't mean to sound, I'm not beating up on them, but what I want to say is they have a job to do, and they're not your friend. They just have a job to do. The key is that they're not a vehicle for you to use to communicate to your stakeholders. You need to communicate directly to your stakeholders. And that's the key. A lot of times we hear people saying, sometimes when you hear people talking about, well, we got to get out in front of this, we got to get our hands around this, we got to get our message out. When you hear those things, slow them down. Why? Why do we need to do that? Why do we need to communicate to them? Why do we need to communicate that way? Why? Just ask that question over and over again. And it slows things down, and you realize, well, we don't have to do that now, or we don't have to do that, don't have to send that message today. And that allows you to be in a position to talk directly to your stakeholders, your parents, your students, your staff. And again, not use the media as your vehicle. Again, building that trust factor, communicate honestly. And in your case, especially with student information, with parent information, you can't share a lot of it. You can't share any of that information. You can't say anything about a student. You can't say anything about if they were involved or not involved. You just have to say that you can't do it. And this commitment shows to your parents and to your student community that you understand that, and you will protect their identities, any issues that might come up. And that's vitally important. You can't do it, and therefore you're showing them your commitment to it. One other thing is work with your first responders. And one of the great things that I find is when I work with a number of schools, and I have, and they talk about their relationship with the fire department and the police department and running exercises with them and working with them. That's a great dialogue. When I hear that, I realize they are doing a good job. So it's great to hear when a headmaster talks about their first responders in that way, that we have a great relationship, and that's something you want to build. And again, keeping that lines of communication open, having them part of your plan is really important. And again, something that is great is that part of your plan. And always remember, these are your commitments, but it's also a living document. It's a continual improvement process. That feedback loop exists here as well. What did we learn? How are these working? And it'll continually change. But having this as kind of the foundation of your communications process really strengthens your commitment, sets the guidelines out, and provides a level of trust and understanding for your families, and especially your families and students. Training is key, and training around these areas. If you see these threatening behaviors or these behaviors of concern, can they be communicated back? Do you have a mechanism in place that if you see these things happening, you can respond quickly to them? If you hear about them on someone's Facebook page or there's tweets and somebody can, is there a mechanism for people who hear and see these to be able to come back to you and say, I've got a concern, I'm seeing these things, or I thought I saw this and I need a way to do it? We do work with a lot of schools on anonymous reporting models. There's lots of good tools out there where people can say, I've seen something, I'm afraid for my friend, I'm concerned, I've seen something at my home or my friend's home that bothers me. Generally, students won't tell you because they don't want to get involved, and it's just something that's difficult for them to do. But if they have an anonymous way to do it, and it can be very simple, it can be nothing more than a suggestion box where somebody can put a piece of paper in and say, I've got a concern. You might get a lot of silly stuff getting in the box, but it only takes one person to say, I'm comfortable enough that I've seen something that I'm afraid of, and I need you to respond to it. And that is those red flags. And before, how do you build an intelligence network? This is a great step. But if people don't know what to report, then it's hard to collect that information. So part of your intelligence network is training your people, your students, your staff, and your teachers to say, if I see these, here's how I report them. Here's how I drive that communication back to the administration so they can respond to it. And the last thing you need to be doing is finding out about these events after the fact. That's tough, because again, that they may not always be true. So that misinformation can cause problems. Being behind the curve can also cause problems as well. I like this slide because it gives some practical examples of some of those steps we talked about. In this particular case, in the left-hand column are obviously things we're all familiar with: evacuation, lockdown. What we've done for schools is then create talking points and said, okay, in the case of evacuation, here's the condition, here's the directive, here's what you say to get people out of the school, and then here's the action, and lockdown, and so on. You can use the same model for those behaviors of concern. That you don't necessarily need to every one of them, because a lot of them would be very similar. But using the same model to say, okay, what's that behavior? How do I communicate? What's the action? If I see something, who do I tell? How do I respond to it? And in turn, from a teacher's perspective or a parent's perspective, here's what you do. So opening those lines of communication allows you as part of that bill. But if you have these simple details and simple steps and protocols in place, then again, there's no confusion. People know what to do, and you can see them. So again, your teachers, if they see those behaviors of concern, know exactly what to do. And if there's feedback from the student body, then you or the teachers know exactly what to do. And again, building that intelligence network allows you to avoid that having to deal with information that's out there in the marketplace as after the fact. This slide really depicts a typical escalation process, and this is kind of what happens in an event. You have an incident, you have an incident that's out there, then typically a teacher, an advisor hears about it, they report it to the head, dean of students, dean of faculty, maybe a threat assessment team. So my question is, are those protocols we just talked about all in place so that that flow of information is kind of seamless, that it moves seamlessly? Are the people trained at each level so that they can A, move the information or collect the information, and then, you know, respond quickly to the event, which allows you to have that communication process in place? And the students, again, through either an anonymous reporting model, or if your two students are comfortable enough, that's great, but at least they're aware that they can report these things, they can make these comments, what they will know will get addressed. I want to bring this up. Is we've created these maturity matrices for different companies and schools and environments. And this one addresses kind of your environment. If you look at the last point on the column, on the right left-hand column, communication effectiveness. This is a great tool with your crisis management team or your threat assessment team to walk through and say, where are we on these four stages? And you can imagine if you're in stage one, confusing messages, highly reactive, you don't know your key channels, your messages are not timely, so you don't know who your stakeholders are, you don't know what kind of messages make sense to them, their messages would be confused, you're slow to respond to them. You can imagine the type of confusion, misinformation, the type of reaction that might happen in a time of a crisis at your school. As you move through the continuum across the bottom, you can see where there's more control. You can see where you know who you're talking to. You can see where you're creating messages in the beginning before this happens. You're creating guidelines for those messages. And this allows you to be much more succinct, have cogent messages that are delivered timely without the confusion, to avoid dealing with those consequences. So again, great opportunity to look at this and say, where are we on this? And what are the steps we need to do to put more control around this process? And again, you can take a look at that, and we can share some of that information with you if you're interested. And that way you can use it in your training as you start to say, okay, what do we need? What do we need to get better? And some of those steps are very straightforward. Try to develop that intelligence network, whether it's with tools to collect information, if it's simply a starting point as an anonymous reporting system for your student body is a great starting point. But work to collect that information and develop that insight with working with the Firestorms, looking at our website to collect some of that insight so that you can have that intelligence to make decisions. Creating an awareness and prevention training, just as I said, using the maturity matrix to say what are the steps we need to do to have a very tight communications program. And then always a security assessment is great, both for your physical security, but your IT security, and even in, you know, your messaging. You want to make sure that the information you're providing is information you can provide, especially when it comes to students. So make sure those guidelines are in place. Have a plan. If you have a response plan today, have a crisis communication section. Maybe have a crisis communications plan that's separate, which deals with these issues of who do we communicate with, how do we avoid that misinformation getting into the marketplace, how do we respond if misinformation is out there, and it can get out there very simply, and creating what we call message maps, or those protocols that allow you to respond quickly and allow you to not, in the middle of a crisis, start to try to create these, but tailor them to the environment. And then, again, training is the key. Doing tabletops with your team, working through scenarios, and looking at what, you know, what you have in place. And again, using that performance matrix is a great way to use it as a guideline. Insurance is key, especially now that cyber is becoming such a big issue. Are you fully protected? Do you have enough protection if something should happen? Keeping your current response plans up to place. And something we have on our website, which is interesting, is a behaviors of concern user group, which is a great sounding board, and a lot of great tips and ideas, and something that, that, as you said, as you build that intelligence network, how did other people do it? What did they do when they see the red flags? How did they respond quickly? And so, again, something you can look at and might be attractive to join. And finally, we do have a brief. We create a brief for these webinars, and the brief you can get from our webpage. You can download it or call our 800 number. We'll get it to you and direct you in the right place. For it, and you know, my email is first initial last name, so it's bneville@firestorm. Send me any questions. I'll be more than happy to get back to you with the information. And I would suggest that get the brief and share it if you know, you have a crisis management team or a crisis response team or a crisis assessment team. Get it and share it around, because I think it's good reading, and use it as a training tool for your group. So again, that's the presentation today. I don't know if there's any other. Rick, do you have any comments or Bill?
This is Rich, and I just wanted to thank you for a great presentation on the myths of containment. I also wanted to talk about some other events that are coming up for TAIS.
Oh, great. Okay. We've
got the Tech Institute at Answorth High School. April 25th, that's a Monday, a great event for technology integration into the classroom. April 27th, the Heads and Trustees Workshop at Hutchinson School in Memphis. The speaker will be Kirk Walker, president of SAIS, former longtime head of Macaulay School in Chattanooga. April 29th, the Consultative Business Officers Half-Day Workshop, done by Blackbaud for us. And on May 3rd, a Managing Your Online Presence Workshop with special emphasis on managing social media, a half-day workshop done for us by Blackbaud. So don't miss those great events as well. Thanks again, Blair and Firestorm. Thank you.
No, thank you. We appreciate your support. And as I say, anybody who has any questions, then come back to us. We'd love to address them. And you know, and we'll do our fifth series next month. And again, thank you very much for your attention. And that concludes our program for today.